So, Dr. Johnathan Wright, you were talking about berberine, and you were comparing it to metformin, which is a medication for diabetes.
Right.
Really impressive results, reducing cholesterol, triglycerides, glucose after 90 days.
Oh, well, remember,
yeah.
One thing, these aren't my studies. These are studies published in journals called Metabolism and Journal of Endocrinology and Metabolism.
Yes.
And what those researchers showed is that the berberine could reduce the blood sugar, not just in 90 days, but the majority of the beneficial effect was within the first 10 days.
Oh, nice.
And the blood sugars would come down significantly in that time. Now, they did extend their studies to 90 days to see how much further they could get, and they did get a little further.
Yeah.
But it lowered the blood sugar, it lowered the hemoglobin A, of course, right along with it. But oddly enough, it raised the good cholesterol and it lowered
the
bad
LDL.
Cholesterol.
Yeah.
And all around, it's one of the better things one can do for if you have type 2 diabetes, or if you don't want to get type 2 diabetes and you think you're on the way because your doctor's done the appropriate test to find out.
And little or no side effects. If they had a little GI effect and you just reduced from 500 milligrams 3 times a day to 300 milligrams 3 times a day.
Well, the important part is that most of the side effects came when the berberine was taken with a patent medication or some other treatment. And when they were separated, there were no side effects.
Beautiful, beautiful. Yeah. You also cleared up something for me, and that was that I've read on the internet and elsewhere that berberine isn't something you would continually take, and you made an elegant statement regarding the microflora and the bacteria. And
well,
tell
it was
us about
actually
that.
Elegant research.
Yes, okay.
What the research did was to examine the entire bacterial flora. How do you do that? By DNA studies.
Wow.
They did DNA of each of the little bacteria in the gut, and this was in experimental animals now. And so they ID'd, oh, here's all these different bacteria, and then, in a number of animals, and then they had fed them berberine, or they had them feed themselves berberine, I forget which, and after X amount of months, they then went and did the DNA analysis on the microbiome after berberine, and they found out that, sure enough, while a certain number of bacteria simply disappeared, those were all the bacteria we don't want to have anyway.
The bad ones.
And the good ones almost entirely survived. So there are other herbs that are known to do that, though. We know, for example, that oregano has much the same effect. It will clean out bad bacteria and not touch the good guy bacteria.
Nice.
So that is not a unique thing. It's just nice to know that berberine is in the group that cleans up the bad ones and doesn't much mess with the good ones.
Yeah. So the net result is diabetics tend to have the highest incidence of gangrenous limbs that get amputated. They have a high rate of stroke. They have a high rate of cardiovascular complications.
Sure.
They have ED. And some people feel that it's not just the blood sugar and the insulin metabolism problems, but their elevated LDL, their elevated triglycerides. And what you showed with the berberine.
It was the researchers that showed it.
Yes, yes. What you showed, what you presented based on the research, was that there was an improvement, a significant improvement in the lipid profiles, the glucose.
The triglycerides came down, the HDL went up, the LDL went down. Yeah.
Wow.
Very nice.
Why wouldn't everyone? I mean, it's become epidemic proportion. I mean, people all over the world, not just our country, are suffering from diabetes. So.
Well, of course, though, the berberine is step number three.
Okay.
We have to do the diet right first and the exercise second.
Yes.
And then we bring in the supplements. But berberine is indeed the number one supplement.
Share with us, where we're talking about the herbal interventions, the phytochemical, turmeric, curcumin. Some people say, well, it doesn't absorb very well. So can you just use a fatty acid component, something that would help to improve, or is it just overall absorbed pretty well as it is?
No, it doesn't.
So
there
it does
are
need
the more
some
absorbable curcumin fractions.
Okay.
Now, I'm not aware that that has an enormous impact on diabetes as the berberine does on type 2. We got to be clear, it's type 2 diabetes.
Okay.
But there are a number of other botanicals that also work against diabetes.
Like?
It's just that berberine has assumed number one place.
Okay.
Just because it does so well.
What else have you found in the literature?
Oh, my goodness. There is, what is it? It's the some cucumber, bitter melon, that's it. Bitter melon is helpful. There's stuff in there called gymnema. It's an Ayurvedic herb.
Nice.
There's several more. Those I tend to keep on a not on a file card anymore, but in the right place in the computer so I can find them all.
Yes.
Yeah, but there are several botanicals that will
beautiful,
do that.
Beautiful, beautiful. Mm-hmm. And clearly a diabetic's going to benefit from exercise, from mm-hmm. healthy diet, mm-hmm. from better sleep.
Sure. And remember, there's even research on what kind of exercise does best.
Intense?
The intense exercise,
yes.
The so-called interval training, mm-hmm. or putting yourself into anaerobic metabolism briefly. You don't want to overdo it for too long. You get lactic acid too much in your muscles.
Except for those people with the genetic deficiency of lactic acid.
You can't make lactic acid, that's true. So the benefit of the exercise has been, let me put it another way.
Yes.
Let me start over again here. Start, reset. And that is that with the intense interval training type exercise, mm-hmm. it does much better than jogging.
Yes.
Than moderate aerobic exercise.
I'm glad you say that, because that's mm-hmm. I'm a big proponent of. I enjoy it myself. I experience mm-hmm. the benefits. So a person who starts out, doesn't want to start out real intense, is a little hard on their body
you
to adjust.
You work into it.
You work into it.
You
build
it,
up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very good. So mm-hmm. in working through with the combination of, do you think it's appropriate to take phytochemical herbs and supplements and work them together with bioidentical hormones where it's necessary? I mean, there's a point where some people need some hormonal support as well,
well
too.
Well, it's not only appropriate, it's a damn good idea.
Right.
Because we're trying to look at the health of the whole body.
Right.
Not just the blood sugar regulation system, mm-hmm. which is an important one, but still, yeah. it's the whole body. The only one we have to be really careful about is the testosterone.
Yeah.
Just about all the hormones help to improve the blood sugar, and testosterone can too. But darn it, when we have the type 2 diabetes, that if we still have the high insulin signal, it can make too much testosterone turn into estrogen, and that's very counterproductive for guys.
Yes.
So we have to be much more careful about the use of testosterone. I'm not saying don't use it. I'm
right.
saying we have to do all the monitoring to make sure we're not hyperaromatizing, and we have to get that not blocked with a patent medicine, but we have to get that slowed down by natural means.